Good afternoon. So we will be actually sitting between you and your lunch, right? We will try and wrap this up. Vandana has been doing a phenomenal job at timekeeping, and we'll make sure that we end at one sharp. I have a fairly easy responsibility, actually, because I have been firsthand seen the story unfold in front of my eyes. What we're going to do is split this discussion into three clear parts: before, which is before 2010 when Abhijit started Praxify, and then during Praxify he had 7 odd years, and what does he plan to do next. So going over straight to questions and answers, Abhijit, tell us your drive to start Praxify, and what where was it? Something in COEP or something in your first few jobs? Tell us about your journey before Praxify.
So, hi everyone. Healthcare was completely new to me before Praxify. I had no clue about healthcare. While I was studying back then in Kodito days or Azingo days, I was a mobility guy. I started my career as doing compilers and writing and bootstrapping compilers for different microcontrollers and microchipsets, and then moved along to build a platform very similar to Android back in 2005 and 6, which got acquired by Motorola. In the phase of about 2009-ish in the end, what struck me bad was an episode with my mom where she was diagnosed with diabetes, just because two very good doctors in Pune could not see each other's prescriptions in time, and both were prescribing steroids to her, and I am like an educated fool going ahead and pushing mom to be taking the medications on time. So that really triggered the urge of trying to figure out what's going on here and why can't like two good doctors can also see each other's prescription. That got me into healthcare. The initial anger that started with doctors, you know, why the hell these guys can't see, manifested in figuring out that, as Parag rightly said, you know, doctors really don't have time. They're seeing about 100, 120, 150 patients a day, and you get about 2 to 3 minutes per patient, out of which you're carrying a bunch of file in front of the doctor without having a knowledge how to arrange it with x-rays and MRIs in different folders and files, and he's basically able to gauge whatever is being presented in that context to him. And that's where the problem lied. So if you look at healthcare per se, and you look at the ecosystem of healthcare, every health company talks about getting patients at the center of care. But really, is the patient at the center of care? Is the question that I started asking myself when I started Praxify. And for answering that question, what I tried to do was, we started looking around what are the components of healthcare and where does the data flow. So if you look at the healthcare ecosystem, there are doctors and physicians, hospitals, clinics, labs, diagnostics, pharmacies, pharma companies, insurance companies, clinical research organizations, government organizations, and so on and so forth. And the primary producer and consumer of data in this ecosystem is the physician. And data flows via the physician in different formats like orders and claims and secondary data analysis and reports to different all these different stakeholders. Now, if you look at physicians worldwide, not just in India, they were ill-equipped by entering structured data or consuming structured data. And that is where we started focusing on to solve this problem of really getting the patient at the center of care.
Amazing. So that's how this whole idea of Praxify started. But I remember 2010-11, you made a very conscious decision of saying that you will be on iPad only. No iPhone, no Android, only iPhone. And that time, you know, it was a very, very bold decision because iPads were still expensive. India was not the India that we see today. And so tell us about iPad.
So this is an interesting question. You know, the way we went about addressing the problem was, there were like 4,000 odd different electronic health record companies in US and many more in India. And everybody was just saying the same thing. I didn't want to become the 4,000 first company saying that I've got 3 features more than anybody else. So what we did is we took a bunch of doctors across the globe, thanks to a few help from, you know, connects and one of our chief medical officer who was in Stanford. We connected to a bunch of doctors and roped in a design house to try and understand what really happens between a doctor and patient at the point of care, both at the bedside and at the office setting. And a couple of things that came out very evidently was when you put a computer, a keyboard or a mouse in front of a doctor and there is a bunch of files and papers lying there and there are two patients sitting out, or a patient and a kin, and there's a resident doctor standing behind. The doctor's trying to look into some paper and trying to figure out where to click, what to type where. And he's completely lost the intuition power he's got and trained as a doctor. That workflow had to be eliminated. The keyboards and the screens and the papers had to be eliminated so that he could focus back to the patient. And that's where the idea of getting everything on a device like iPad came into picture. iPad, basically, when Steve Jobs announced iPad, is the time, the day it was announced is the day I resigned from Azingo Motorola, because that device really intrigued me. Working in the devices space for a long, I figured out that this would be the device that could really solve what was going on from a experienced perspective to the doctor.
And I think you will have to thank Pune as an ecosystem, because immediately after that you got Ruby Hall as your first customer and you've been growing with them steadily throughout.
Yeah, Ruby Hall was an interesting thing. We were trying to create use cases, and you know, when we started working on designing of the solution, we created this concept called zero type, where we wanted to eliminate typing from the point of care. And that we wanted to try it out and pilot it out locally so that we could learn from it. So when we went to Ruby Hall, we understood that, you know, A, the doctors loved it. Second, we really figured out that every doctor has its own way of practicing. These specialties, their workflows were very different. So we took a backseat, and when we were working with Ruby, we figured out that we have to work on a specialty-specific framework. So we studied about 16 specialties back then, figured out their clinical and data models, workflows. Whatever could be made in a framework, in a common site, we did it. And then we did specializations and verticalizations of each of these specialties. Went back to the doctors, they loved it. Very soon, post the pilot, when we went live with a larger group, we realized that not just specialties, but every doctor has a very different way of practicing medicine. And we have to cater to that way so that the doctor can get his eye point with the patient. And that's where Mira got born, which is the digital assistant that we created. It's a virtual assistant that was created inside the iPad, where she could, you know, not just be there for the whole time, but she could take commands and she could speak to the doctor, could learn from how the doctor is practicing and produce the data in real time to the doctor.
Amazing. So, and after that, I think coming out of thin air, it was Ram, who was more of a friend, investor. So tell us about Ram.
Yeah, so Ram was introduced to me by one of our investors, and he was the guy that I was looking for from a sales perspective predominantly, because we always had aims to go global, and I was very close to the product and to the design and the team here. So we wanted someone who could help me in getting things done in US, and which is where Ram played a role, stepped in, and we went abroad and we started working out on figuring out what is the best thing that we could do. That was around 2013. 2013 is the time frame that we came. We got multiple more hospitals here in India, but our focus was to how do we cater into the US market. And by then, 2013 and 2014 was the time when EHRs were already proliferated. They were grabbing the land already in US. And which is when I started thinking about this post-EHR era, saying that irrespective of billions of dollars spent in US, the doctors are facing the same issues that we are facing with pen and paper here in India. So how do we solve that issue with a solution which can sit on top of these EHRs?
Okay, that's amazing. So, and immediately after that, you started multiple partnerships with large IT companies, and that was your GTM, your go-to-market strategy, especially in the US, and that started your US drive. So how was it, you know, operating out of India? So maybe you could touch a little bit on the India versus US or...
It's an interesting thing. Back in 2014 when, you know, we got a call from Apple. It was an inbound call because Manipal Hospitals, where we were live, had placed an order of 1,000 iPads. And that was the highest order placed by an healthcare unit in India to Apple back then. So Apple was completely, you know, in shock on understanding who these guys are. So we were invited to Cupertino. We were in their design labs, and we came into this story of mobility partner program. They had a secret program that Tim Cook recently unveiled to the world. We were early partners to that. And that triggered a thought process of, you know, how do we align ourselves to the great strong tech players, because we were small, we were in India, we wanted some, you know, elephant to go to the next stage and climb up there. So that is where Apple, Microsoft and NTT Data, which was Dell earlier on, came into picture. Dell basically had a service arm for healthcare services, which served about 52% of the healthcare services market in India, in US. And that is where we saw that we could play a very strong role, because I didn't want to create an army of people trying to do integration and implementation, which is a huge, huge thing in US especially. So Dell took that you know, job, and we could focus on the product more strongly.
You want to compare at this time, compare the US market with India market?
It's an interesting question, Sandeep, and if there's one thing that I want to tell everybody here, the learning that I had from the journey in Praxify is, these two markets are very different, very, very different. You cannot have a product built for one market being used to the other. The complexities of the market are different, the compliance issues are different, the entire philosophy of how things work are very different. Here you are, as someone pointed out in the earlier thing, you basically are trying to appease the doctor. There, that's not the case. You're not trying to appease the doctor, you're trying to do the right thing. So one thing is that if you're creating a product which is global in nature, especially in healthcare, we need to be aware of the facts, of these facts especially, of the differences between what the workflows would be for both India and US. India being an early stage market, the revenues are very, very critical. You know, even with approximately about 80 plus hospitals that we were live at, our revenues were very small as compared to 3 go lives that we had in US. So that's like giving you a perspective of the revenue side on both India and US.
We heard Shashank in the morning talk about the B2C space, and you have been primarily on the B2B space. So what was your call for being in that space?
Yeah, my thought process was healthcare would slowly go top down, and it's coming true in certain extent for the US market, where large hospitals and health systems are gobbling up smaller health practices and ambulatory providers. So the call was always to go top down, because decisions in healthcare that I saw were always from top down rather than from bottoms up. Trying to appease every player in the market and equipping them was a job that Shashank did much better than me.
Okay. Everybody is waiting for the $1 billion story, the exit to Athena Healthcare.
Yeah, you know, exits, as many, many entrepreneurs who are here, elderly entrepreneurs who've been mentors, would say it's all, you know, in the path, figuring out. We were looking for raising a round is when I met Jonathan Bush in Bangalore. Just in one of these healthcare conferences, I met him on the outside for a couple of minutes, and I was talking to him about Mira, and he got really intrigued with that, and he called his senior leadership, whoever there with him, all together, and that 2 minutes discussion went on for 45 minutes. And since then, till June, we finished the acquisition, and I'm happy that Mira could find a home in Athena Health, because the ethos and the culture of Athena Health and what Praxify was built on are very similar. They want doctors to be doctors, and they really practice that strongly. So now Mira can go along and sit in the hands of more than 100,000 doctors, which are already in the Athena network in US.
You want to talk about your journey from your home office at Karve Road and then your office at Karve Road, which is pretty tiny, and then to a swank office.
You've seen all that.
I've seen all that live. And your phenomenal office under Post 91 on Bane Road.
I always remember the first day post my job when I opened the keys to the office near Kamala Nehru Park. It was a small 350 square feet office. We grew there from no one to about 20 odd people there. And the first day I entered and there was nothing. And I had to start from there. So it was from there to Post 91 is a good story. I think it's people. I would always give it to my team. A great set of people that I found. I was lucky enough to get the set of people that I'm working with still from start to now, making an impact to the journey.
Okay. want to ask you your learnings in this journey that you would want to share with everybody? Do's, don'ts.
Yeah, I'm, a couple of things, and just take it with a pinch of salt and whatever value you want to take out from it. I am seeing a few startups here which were, given as a list to me earlier on also. And many people can pass the first phase of creating a POC well. In healthcare, POCs can be done really well. But the real thing is how to get that POC into a product, into sellable and scalable product. And I think as an entrepreneur, we need to focus specifically on post POC to product, and which is the phase where most of us fail across because of the compliances, the nuances in healthcare. Nothing else, but because of those reasons. So one learning is that we really need to focus from day one. Even investors need to ask about how are you going to productize the entire POC? How are you going to actually scale it across? With all the issues and concerns that we all know are there in healthcare.
Any more learnings? I'm sure everybody is wanting to hear, and we have some time. We have time on our end.
I would be happy if I can answer a few questions rather than, I don't like to share whatever I have in my story, but
so
maybe.
Before that, let me just ask him, what are his plans for the next 10 years? Where do you see himself 10 years from now?
I'm locked in for some time with Athena for now, so I'm hoping to scale what I created to a larger audience in Athena. But your entrepreneur heart, once you're done, you're going to look at solving another major problem and look for help and be part of the community.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much. So we'll open the floor to questions. Again, can we get you to come up to the microphones and ask your question, if you start with your name?
Yeah, hi Abhijit. So congratulations, I am Dr. Madhura Vipra, and I happen to run a consultancy named Athena in Pune.
Great.
So my question to you is slightly mundane but very important, because you happen to mention that your team is what you give your credit to, most of the credit to. I have a question, how to build a team? During the process, when you are small, when you have nothing, when you just have an empty house or an empty flat or an empty office, from there to here. So any tips on that would be highly appreciated.
I mean, it's not one single answer to how to build a great team. You need to be a good seller of your vision, because when you are young and when you have nothing, you just have your vision with you. So when you're able to sell your vision to others, when you've got that internal gut about whatever happens, I'll be there doing this, the guy who you're talking to understands that and is able to relate to it. So you need to figure out people who can relate to passion for healthcare, especially in the healthcare domain, because many of the team members that I have got in my team have something to do with healthcare in their families or health issues in their families, and they would want to do something and give back to the community. And that gets, how you can form a team which is more passionate about doing things in the space.
So getting them to think about the greater purpose.
Absolutely.
Yeah? Okay, great.
Let me add to this. I've actually seen this with Mohan and Anil that I know personally. So I met Anil recently in his office. This was 9 o'clock in the night. we had gone there for dinner and he had not gone home for the last 48 hours. He worked overnight because now Athena is in US and the team that he has just works through India time for development and client interaction times, and so amazing team that Abhijit has been able to build. Very, very dedicated, very, very committed.
Great. Okay, next question. Can we go to the mic at the back and then we'll come back to the front one?
Hi, Abhijit. My name is Preeti and I know you have worked in India as well as US markets. So I see a lot of health focus now into health afterwards, but what is your view on wellness and what is the differentiating factor between both the markets and what can India do to get ahead in wellness?
Preeti, I think we've discussed a lot offline as well on this. I think predominantly what we can learn from different markets, especially US, who've spent billions, is to focus on wellness. And it starts from the house. So I personally believe that the next 10, 15 years would be in wellness than in healthcare or illness, and which is where everybody would be driven to. People are getting more and more aware about their healthcare. They're getting more and more aware about what to do about their healthcare. So healthcare education would also play a big role. Insurance would play a big role in realizing that fact to every individual.
Thank you. At the front?
Yeah, hello, Abhijit. Amazing achievement. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm a founder of a healthcare services company, Vitalife Clinic. We run a chain of clinics in Pune and Bangalore. So my question is, you said 80 hospitals versus 3 go lives in US, appeasement to doctor in India versus protocols in US. Like, is there a focus on India market now or it's abandoned?
With Athena? I think the major focus is in US. Okay. Of course, because of the acquisition, they'll have certain focus in India, but my major focus is now again be shifted to US. I spend about 15 odd days in Boston and 15 here. So it's that's the crux of the answer.
Okay, so I mean, you're not looking at Indian customers going ahead?
Not immediately.
Okay, and one last question, like there's a Apple Pencil. Is that also like sort of used in your products? And
yeah, I mean, Pencil just came out, I think, a couple of years back. The product was way early on, but we use Pencil for annotations and, okay, you know, but not for handwriting recognition.
Okay.
I'm not of the view of letting doctors still, you know, scribble.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, great. And we'll still have problems reading their handwriting.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, at the back.
Hi, I'm Vivek. I'm working on an early stage healthcare startup. Want to get your view on physician adoption or appeasement, as you call it, India versus US, and what we as entrepreneurs can learn and pitfalls to avoid or ways to go. So,
I mean, we need to make a choice, Vivek, whether we want to keep appeasing physicians here in India versus creating products with protocols that would be used across the globe. I'm not saying that you don't need to appease physicians outside India, but there are lot of things that are taken care by standards, pretty much, which you can follow and create products which can scale.
Yeah, hi, my name's Hans. I just want to ask a question. From your initial days, how much has your vision changed or been compared to now? So how can you just give us an idea of the company and the vision? How much has that changed?
Yeah, the vision was always to get the patient at the center of care. And I think that is still there and it is still continuing with Athena as well. The only way we went about doing the vision from the start was to making the doctor empowered to ensure that the patient is the point of care. And we're still doing the same story, irrespective of the acquisition.
Hello, myself, Dr. Suhas. Yeah. Till now, we are looking at a phase where doctors are at the center of gathering the data, putting in the data. and you've come up with a brilliant solution like Mira for the doctors. Now we are in the next few years, we are into an interesting phase where the machines would be coming in picture for gathering the data. And next, the patient themselves would be, there are a few feedbacks in healthcare like the machines won't give them. Like for example, the perceived improvement of a patient would be different than the parametric improvement what the machines are giving. Now these, when these two entities are coming into picture for gathering the data, and now I'm trying to ask you a question that what would be your quick tips for developing such an ecosystem where the patients are entering their data, where the machines are entering at the data, and where more of in the patient context, how would that system be for the data to flow easily in the natural process of the patient's whole, his own natural life cycle?
I think patients, I believe in some form, small form, patients are still putting in data while at the check-in systems or, you know, filling up the medical history forms, maybe not in a structured manner, but in some manner to the doctors. Would machines be able to replace doctor-driven data? No, I don't see that. We will only be able to assist doctors, machines will only be able to assist doctors in filling in data. And nothing against Watson or all these big plays. Healthcare needs much more smaller innovations that can make life much, much better rather than, you know, ability to just detect cancer automatically. So my thought process on this market has always been to be a trusted assistant to a doctor and be also be able to provide as much as care beyond the four walls to the patient using the patient solutions that we've developed.
I have a question for Abhijit. Which is on the funding part, and he has very successfully convinced his father to invest money in his company early on. So would want you to talk about.
Yeah, initially when I was running behind the story, for whatever reasons I didn't want to focus on raising funds. I believed so much in that I asked my dad to sell all his whatever equity shares that he had invested in and fund me for this project. And eventually, I think as things moved on, then we got some great investors on board and scaled the company. But the thought process was that you please believe in me, we'll do something great. And thankfully, with God's grace, we could do that.